Let us have a hypothetical scenario. Tomorrow, let us assume you are the DM of a particular district and the district is going to through a kind of disaster or catastrophe. You have to manage the same thing. But at the same time, at your personal level, you are going through some kind of at your personal level, you are going through the same kind of scenario what your parents had gone through. So how would you address the scenario? Would you look into your personal life or would you really think about managing the district? Because from your past experience, it seems that you are not able to manage the present. That is the reason why you underperformed. How would you deal with the present scenario?
Event took place 18 years back, and there is a lot of experience which I gained over the years. So something which is important is not to let personal situations have an impact on our professional life. There has to be a fine balance which needs to be maintained, and obviously being a part of the civil services of pivotal importance, since the priority shall be addressing the issues concerned with the disaster.
So you are ready to sacrifice your personal life for the sake of your professional life. Is it true?
So that is what I have been pursuing so far. So yes, I'm ready to sacrifice my personal life at the stake of the matters related to our country, sir.
Okay. So one more thing, in your DAF, it has been observed that you are an architect, right?
Yes, sir.
See, recently what it has been observed, especially in the states of Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, and in all these states, continuously there was either cloud burst or lake burst. Recently, yesterday also, there were boulders had fallen, leading to a bridge getting collapsed and 9 people dying. So,
yes,
see, if you see the entire country's planning, especially in those states, whether it is for hydel power projects or whether it is for regulation of rivers, whatever may be, what would be, because of all these things and man-made disasters, so many things are happening and so many people are dying. So,
yes,
as you being an architect who can plan the things well, how would you try to deal with state planning in these states pertaining to whether building infrastructure or whatever might be? How would you resolve these issues?
So firstly, before initiating any constructions, the hazard mapping of those areas has to be done, in my opinion. And secondly, sir, environment impact assessment also needs to be inculcated before going further with any development plans. So including all the stakeholders and coming to a consensus-oriented decision would be the first step. Secondly, sir, I would also like to see that encroachments and buildings which comply with the seismic zones norms are constructed so that we pursue disaster resilient architecture, and this will reduce the overall catastrophe and the casualties which we have witnessed so far.
So you mean to say that regarding the present damage of infrastructure in those states, the preemptive measures or whatever proactive measures what you have advocated now, do you feel that those things were not done? No environmental impact assessment had not been done, or all the stakeholders were not approached, or all the other regulations pertaining to environmental norms are not followed? That's what you say?
So, I feel those norms would have definitely been pursued to a great extent. However, sir, natural calamities and their gravity cannot be assessed. Cloud bursts or earthquakes which take place. So, sir, I feel that measures are being taken from the government's side. However, more cautiousness should be taken place. I mean, we should address it with more caution, the matter that is, so that such calamities do not wreak havoc.
So you mean that even though there were laws and rules, they were not followed in letter and spirit? That's what you are trying to say?
What I'm trying to mention is that we cannot assess the gravity of natural disasters sometimes. Despite pursuing earthquake resistant buildings, there is a high chance that if the magnitude of an earthquake is great, then the building may fall. Likewise, landslides and cloudbursts are similar events. So better planning and coordination can be carried out.
Okay. See, one more thing. In your DAF, it has been observed that you play volleyball as well as you are also interested in playing chess. Is it correct?
Yes,
sir. See, and what I have observed, no, whether when coming to the games like volleyball, they don't need state-of-the-art infrastructure or something, but minimal infrastructure with proper support would help you to actually groom the game as well as develop the game. Could you please tell, because the funding or something which is required for these games is not that much when compared to other games like tennis or golf or whatever might be. So could you please tell why Indian volleyball team is not at all performing well, whether it is men's or women's team, they are not at all performing well. And I think there is a very slim chance of Indian volleyball team getting a medal in the current Olympics also. Could you please throw some light why it is happening?
So firstly, the Indian, we have seen that cricket is being promoted to a great extent and we have a lot of followers following cricket. So most of the fundings get channelized for cricket as a priority. So various other sports comparatively receive lesser funds. And sir, as for competitive levels, sir, India, we would hardly witness international competitions where India participates apart from the once in a year tournaments that are happening. Whereas in cricket, we see that players go to play to various other countries. This is not something which is being replicated in volleyball or table tennis or tennis for that matter. So exposure level of players gets reduced to a great extent. And sir, from the marketing perspectives, yes, there has been some infrastructural development. And as you had mentioned, we do not require grand creations for volleyball and such sports. But marketing efforts have also been less. Nevertheless, presently we are having the Pro Volleyball League and at the national level, we have various 5 to 6 teams that are competing. So, this is a positive.
So, what better could be done to promote volleyball in our country?
So, we can conduct regular tournaments. We can send our players to countries like Brazil, Poland and Argentina, where we would find excellent players. And when our players get exposure to playing with better teams, then their levels are definitely going to augment to a great scale. And talking of the Olympics, India did try to get qualified. However, as far as my knowledge is concerned, sir, I feel India is not qualified for the Olympics.
Okay. Yeah, one more thing. You said these reasons for volleyball. Could you please tell, after Vishwanath Anand, India couldn't really produce some chess greats in the past 20 years, where chess just requires your cognitive capabilities, but not any kind of infrastructure or something. So could you please tell on the World Forum why India is not able to produce great players like Vishwanath Anand?
We have produced several great players like Bhaskaran Madiban or Vidit Gujarati. So we have 68 grandmasters from India presently.
Yeah.
In countries like Russia and the United States, there are very well-developed academies and chess is also promoted to a great extent. If we go to open parks, we would find players playing chess on a larger scale. So there is state support. And sir, secondly, as we witness chess being a mind game right from childhood, children would, after their studies want to refresh their minds and take less of that cognitive load. So that could be one of the reasons why chess is not pursued from the nascent stages and only we find a few players.
So what could be done to promote chess in our country?
So we have various interstate tournaments which are being organized. What can be done is we can invite international players like Magnus Carlsen or Ian Nepomniachtchi as representatives. And tournaments need to be organized in India as well, where players from all around the world, at least the first 50 grandmasters can be brought and the Indian players can get a chance to play with such players. So that could be one of the measures which can be
But don't you think in the present scenario, even online chess has become so popular, do you think that they should be they should be really invited to our country to play the chess or to promote chess?
So I agree with you. What I mean is that exposure level will be better for our players. So virtually also right now we are witnessing there are several online chess tournaments which are being conducted, so that is also a very good alternative.
Okay. Sir, you can take the baton.
Okay. So, Mr. Sohan, yes, you are from Ahmedabad.
Yes.
And you have done bachelor's in architecture. So,
yes.
So, see, Ahmedabad has a problem of slums, right?
Yes, sir.
You know if any slums in Ahmedabad?
So there used to be slums in the early 2000 times. However, the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation had gone forward with a slum networking project. And in that project, at least 60 to 70 slums and 13,000 households were being catered to, and various amenities like tap water and affordable housing, and these measures were taken so that the slums could be removed and better facilities could be provided to the people.
So you mean to say as of now there are no slums in Ahmedabad as of now?
So there would be slums in a very few pockets. However, it won't.
Can you name a major pocket? Can you name a major pocket? Such pocket.
Sir, we have the Gulbai Tekra area and the Ramdev Nagar area where there are a cluster of slums, and these are usually laborers who create the Ganpati images out of models out of plaster of Paris, and the same is circulated throughout India. So this is where I have seen some slums.
Okay, Mr. Chauhan. The Gulbai Tekra, which you told just now, I think even now it is a large slum area, right? If you are made the CEO of Urban Development Authority of Ahmedabad, how would you add to what the government has already done? Whatever government measures you talked about in the last few minutes, what additional things would you do in order to solve this slum problem in Gulbai Tekra or surrounding regions?
Sir, firstly, before implementing any designs from a top-down approach, consulting the slum dwellers, what are their requirements, what are their problems, be it hygiene, sanitation, or any other amenities which are not being provided to them. These need to be firstly inculcated in the design process. Secondly, various staff agencies like the electricity or the piped water or solid waste management and the likes, the agencies which are dealing with these measures, they need to be brought on the table. And then an integrated approach can be practiced where planning is done, and at every stage of this, the execution happens in a phased manner. So we keep on adapting and working out on what all are the pros and cons of execution as well.
Mr. Chauhan, sorry to interrupt you, but you are telling very broadly that they should be consulted, we are doing a phase-wise manner, we should take a holistic picture. Yes, I understand. Your answer is very broad. But can you tell me specific measures either from your architectural background or affordable housing, can you tell me specific measures? Okay, you will take the consensus of all the offices and the slum dwellers. But finally, yes, using your experience as an architect, tell me some solutions in a limited area.
In a limited area, sir, the plans have to be created with respect to the density of that area. So we cannot provide any lavish houses to them. Minimum basic room and kitchen spaces and toilets within.
How would you cut the cost? How would you cut the cost of construction in order to build affordable housing?
So I would employ the slum dwellers and enroll them in the MGNREGA factor as well. So this provides them with an opportunity to make their earnings and their durable assets, the physical assets, get created as well. So it becomes that circular exercise.
Any specific material you want to use? Any latest specific material in the construction do you want to use, which would cut down the cost?
So we have fly ash bricks, which are being pursued lately. And we have manufacturing sand. However, that is to a little, it is a little expensive. So procuring materials from the local areas would cut down on the cost. That would be one of the aspects. And sir, we are not looking towards any grand architecture. So as long as we are creating brick and mortar constructions which address the basic necessities of the individuals, that should be a satisfying option.
Okay, Mr. Chauhan. You might have heard about the recent Land Grabbing Prohibition Act implemented by Gujarat. You know about that?
I'm sorry, sir. I'll have to read more on that.
Have you heard? Because right now it is all over the newspapers of Gujarat. Land Grabbing Prohibition Act. Can you take a guess? Land grabbing prohibition is an act which prohibits the land grabbing. Though you do not know the act, have you heard about the background? Miss, can you guess why such an act is required in Gujarat? Such a harsh act, why it may be required according to you?
Sir, there could be instances where constructions have taken place without taking the without being authorized by the Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority or the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation. So these areas which belong to the government might have been usurped by private entities. And this is one of the reasons why this could have been brought into place. We also have the Gujarat Regulations for Unauthorized Developments Act, which is the GRUDA Act, which tries to see to it that such developments, haphazard developments, do not take place.
Right, okay. And then, Mr. Chauhan, Gujarat economically is progressing fast, but socially it is backward. If you consider literacy rate, or you consider the empowerment of women there, or the health factors, the criteria of the health, you look at the social indicators, it is still backward. Why this, economic progress, but socially backward? Why it is happening in Gujarat? Tell me three quick reasons.
Sir, in my opinion, Gujarat is not socially backward in that aspect. We have a literacy rate of 80%, where 84% of males are literate and around 70% of females are literate. Secondly, we have various Kendriya Vidyalayas which are created and which are offering education to students. Sir, what has been observed is that Gujarat is pursuing more economic aspects when it comes to the development process, and it is always compared with the Kerala model of development. So while Gujarat tries to focus more on infrastructure creation, ease of doing business, trade facilitation centers and the likes, the resources which the Kerala government devolves are more oriented towards indicators like health, education, employment, skill development and the likes. These are two separate approaches. One is a top-down approach followed by the Gujarat government, whereas the Kerala government is following a bottom-up approach. So they are good in their own manner, and this is
so
what
here why are you comparing the Gujarat with Kerala? In reason specifically?
So, because as you mentioned that socially Gujarat is being perceived as a backward state.
Yes, backward. Socially, Gujarat is backward when you compare the other equally economically developed states of India.
Yes, sir.
It is socially backward. When you take the top 10 economic developed states of India, who are economically progressing really fast, Gujarat is socially backward than the other states. And can you please explain why Kerala, your comparison has come?
So, because Kerala is faring well on the Sustainable Development Goals Index developed by the Niti Aayog, as we've seen. It has it has excelled in the parameters like zero hunger and quality education. Whereas Gujarat has been acing the charts in the goodness and good health and well-being indicator, as well as the industry, innovation, and infrastructure indicators. So okay. That is why I tried to compare the same.
Okay. So again, Mr. Sohan, recently you might have read about social media intermediary rules, the new rules. Have you read them?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So do you agree with those rules completely?
Sir, freedom of expression is an important aspect of our democracy. However, some of the fundamental rights are not sacrosanct in their nature, and there can be instances which would lead to national security issues. So the government is trying to regulate the social media intermediaries, and there are aspects like data privacy and the regulation of OTT platforms. We are supposed to be, the government is having grievance redress.
Yes, true, I agree. Can you tell me the two rules in the new IT rules, the two rules, which are not agreed by most of these social media companies?
So the government, for preserving the national security, wants to trace the originator from where the messages could have been evolved. If we take the example of WhatsApp, so these are encrypted messages and they compromise the privacy of an individual, as had been upheld in the Puttaswamy judgment of 2017. So this is in conflict with what we are professing, and so that is one of the aspects. And secondly, having nodal officers and taking content off from social media platforms, which might incite violence and hurt the sentiments of any community. So the government is trying to preserve the security of the state. The social media intermediaries are located outside India, and they are not responsible for preserving the overall security. They are just being networking the individuals. So it is the responsibility of the government, and hence such proactive measures are being taken.
So finally, you agree with all the rules, right? You don't have any problem with any of the rules. Am I right?
I agree with the rules. Yes, sir.
And you have done your graduation from a place called Anand, right?
Yes, sir.
When you are in Anand, have you gone to any of these national dairy board? Is there any body in Anand regarding dairy?
Yes.
What is the name of the board?
National Dairy Development Board, which is located in Anand. And Anand is famous for the Amul model, given that the Operation Flood carried out by Dr. Varghese Kurian. And
if I ask you to criticize that model developed by Varghese Kurian, if I ask you to criticize the model, can you tell me a few criticisms?
I'm not specifically aware of any criticisms as such.
So you're completely like, the model is perfectly correct. No improvements need to be required, something like that.
Sir, no model is completely perfect. Each and every model is an act in progression. But I believe as far as Amul is concerned, it has been a very successful model, given that India was a milk deficit nation, and right now it is the largest producer of milk. It produces around...
Largest? So even today, India is the largest producer of milk?
So as far as my knowledge is concerned, I think it is placed in the top three. So
is that milk enough for consumption of all the Indians?
So we are also the largest consumers of milk. So addressing
that
becomes with. So we are also exporting milk to a certain extent, but I am not aware of the quantity and the values.
Okay, but have you heard that many countries do not import Indian milk because of SPS reasons? Do you know SPS?
Yes,
what is SPS?
Sir. So it is the sanitary and phytosanitary measures because.
So what is the SPS in the milk? In the milk, what is the SPS?
So there is a quality, a benchmark which is set by a few countries that below such amount of quality, we won't be importing any products
yes.
which would have an impact on the masses.
But Mr. Shohar, I'm expecting from you specific answer for milk. For milk, why many countries are not importing Indian milk? Because SPS measures. Why? What is the SPS? How is SPS related to milk? What may be the reason?
So I'll have to read further on that, sir.
Okay. Mr. Tripath Rao, sir, you can take it, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. See, Mr. Siddharth, your father is a retired DSP.
Yes, sir.
Right? And your mother is a housewife.
Yes, sir.
So, do you think services rendered by housewife should be taken into account for calculating Indian GDP?
So I feel that services given by women should be inculcated in the GDP because there is a lot of unpaid work and a lot of hours are being spent by women catering to the needs of the family, children and the elders. So if this gets contributed to the GDP, our overall productivity and the GDP will increase to a great extent, sir.
Suppose if you are made a member of the statistical commission to include housewife services for calculating GDP, so what would
yes.
you suggest? What type of measures or what type of method would you suggest to calculate services rendered by housewife?
So I would like to work on a chart where it is mentioned as to how many hours are spent given for each and every activity. And there would be rates which can be decided for such activities. Like if we are catering to the needs of the children, making them study and things like that, there has to be something which has to reach out to the women. And
what is that something?
So that needs to be calculated. However, we cannot reach any specific conclusion without this being a participatory exercise. And I think various stakeholders will have to be consulted in this as well, sir.
Okay, you will consider various stakeholders. But what
yes,
formula or what method would you be adopting?
So looking at what is our purchasing power parity, how much is the income of each and every household, then there should be a separate segregation of below poverty line households. And we should see to it that unpaid work for a specific category of people. I'm not talking about castes or religions as such. I'm talking about the from the poverty perspectives. So specific allocations can be made to women belonging to specific slabs, so on and so forth. And there should be a limit as to if women are working, are from well-to-do families, then the contributions which are being made by the government can be reduced.
Okay. So are you aware of these farm bills?
Yes, sir.
Farm bills introduced by the Union government?
Yes, sir.
So are the farm bills going to benefit farmers or they are disadvantages to farmers?
So the farm bills are going to benefit the farmers. Firstly, though it is being perceived that the agricultural sector is getting corporatized, However, it is for the wellness of the farmers. If a grievance redressal mechanism is being set up over there, if there are apprehensions,
how it is going to be benefiting farmers?
I'm sorry, sir, I did not.
How these farm bills are going to be benefiting farmers?
Sir, there is a mechanism of contract farming so that the farmers can engage into contracts with various entities, and their sale is not restricted only to the APMCs, the state APMCs, that is. And sir, secondly, the farmers fear that the MSP regime is going to get dismantled. However, that is not the case. The MSP prices are going to be maintained. And sir, thirdly, sir, this would lead to an interconnectivity. A farmer producing his product in Punjab can make the sale right up to Tamil Nadu or Meghalaya. So this...
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then you're saying that it is going to be benefiting because the monopoly of APMCs would be abolished, right?
So monopoly the intermediaries will also be reduced. So the farmers would be able to fetch
the... Why there has been an agitation on these acts from the states of Punjab and Haryana? In some states, Uttar Pradesh.
Yes, sir. Sir, because as I had mentioned earlier, they feel that if the minimum support price... are not going to be provided, then there could be losses to their produce, given that India faces various...
Is there any provision that MSP wouldn't be provided in these acts? Is there any provision that MSP wouldn't be provided to the farmers? Is there any provision as such?
So this is what is being inferred from the farmers' side, because it has been mentioned that the APMC committees won't be the sole procurers of the produce. So
APMCs are not going to procure. So MSP, the government is not going to give MSP. Is that what you want to convey?
So I'll have to read more on that.
Okay. You said contract farming.
Yes, sir.
But earlier also, government of India allowed contract farming. Have you heard out of the PepsiCo companies lay contract with the farmers of Gujarat, especially the Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh? They had a contract with Lay's company.
Yes, sir, I have heard of it.
But the PepsiCo company dragged some of the farmers from Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat to the court afterwards.
Yes, sir.
What is the issue?
So I'm not aware of the issue. I just have superficial knowledge on that there were contract farming measures like PepsiCo, as you had mentioned, which had taken place. Mm-hmm. The farmers also cannot, having very low incomes, cannot engage themselves in such court processes, which would amount to a lot of fees. And they won't be provided with so much of legal support. This is what I feel. So,
no, that is not the issue, but you can go through the letter. Suppose, yes, but there are because some of the farmers are fearing that corporate will monopolize the Indian farming. But suppose, yes, if you are made a district magistrate in a district, how would you ensure contract farming? And how would you ensure the interests of the farmers are protected?
So contract farming can be carried out in a phased manner. Once we have parameters to assess the success of such a model, then gradually it can be increased rather than it being enforced upon the farmers. If there are a few success stories, then farmers and their peers would gradually want to make more earnings, and this would be beneficial to them in the long run. So carrying out that in a phased manner would be the first step. And sir, this also creates a better overall supply chain management. So that would also help in the process.
Okay. So in your DAF, it can be comprehended that in your work experience,
yes,
you worked as an architect only for 15 days. Sorry, sir, only for 3 months,
yes,
junior architect. And yes. You are getting 15,000. And then you got a job as architecture, there you are getting only 12,000.
Yes.
So why there is a difference? Why the difference? You should get more, no? You got promotion.
Sir, these are two separate aspects. The thing is, after I graduated, I started working at a firm where they were offering me 15,000 as a salary. And the work was, rather than designing, I'm not criticizing the firm, but what I feel is that rather than designing aspects, the work was more of draftsmanship. Hence, I wanted to explore more of the design aspects. And then I started freelancing with a partner. And we continued working for a year. And we did small residential projects and small scale interior projects. After which I continued practicing architecture on a solo basis, and I worked on small interior projects, sir.
So your interests also include reading biblical texts, right?
Yes, sir.
Why do you read biblical texts?
Sir, there are a lot of values which I extract from reading the biblical scriptures on a daily basis. It serves as a platter of motivation to me. Values like forgiveness or tolerance for our fellow beings on a daily basis, that exercise has to be carried out. And other values like compassion, kindness, being gentle to each and every one around us, because I feel that God does not reside in any concrete structures. God resides in the...
Okay, Siddharth, so since when you have been reading biblical scriptures?
I've been reading them since the last 2.5 years.
4.5 years?
2.5 years.
2.5 years.
Yes.
So how did you start reading this Bible? How did you inculcate this habit of reading biblical scriptures?
So I had been to a trip in Maharashtra once, and I had visited a church which was not a traditional church. It was just a communion of individuals, and the Gospel of Matthew was being preached at that time. So I started taking interest in what was being preached, and then I got myself a Bible and I started reading the scriptures. Then I finished the Old Testament and the New Testament.
Okay, so you said that you learned some values from these biblical scriptures, right? So yes, how will you use your experience of reading biblical scriptures as a civil servant?
So practicing empathy becomes very important. So when we are dealing with people, we are being appointed as servants. Service is something that we are offering, and this is not an authoritarian stance. So as we see in the Bible, Jesus himself washed the feet of the apostles. So while we are serving the people, we have to serve people with humility. That is one thing. And sir, if it comes to policing, sir, we have witnessed encounters at times where the police becomes the judge, the jury, and the executioner, whereas the Bible teaches us of forgiveness. Now, what I'm trying to say is that we need not forgive the criminals. However, we need not take the law in our own hands and start delivering justice. So this is the second aspect which can be linked with administration.
So to what extent empathy is important for a civil servant? You mentioned empathy because of your biblical experience. To what extent a civil servant uphold empathy?
So it is the most important aspect for a civil servant. It is a must to have of putting himself or herself in the shoes of people with whom they are interacting, trying to understand what their problems are, and then helping them overcome such issues. This is a true service. So I think it is a foundational value for civil services.
So as a civil servant, what is important? Upholding the law or empathy? If suppose there is a tussle between upholding the law and empathy, so which thing would you prefer?
So empathy is usually accommodative and it won't come into tussle with the law. However, if such a situation does arise, then definitely upholding constitutional values would be of utmost importance.
So you won't be upholding empathy? You won't be empathizers with the victim or the citizen?
That has to be practiced. However, a brute approach need not be practiced. And sir, I feel by practicing empathy, we are actually practicing the constitutional values. So I do not feel that they would ever be in conflict with each other.
So it, with your DAF, okay. I can also see that watching movies is one of your hobbies, one of your interests, right? Hobbies. Yes, okay. So of late, many of the movies have been released in OTTs.
Yes, sir.
Not in theaters. Do you think future of the movies dependent on OTT?
So we have witnessed a great spread in the OTT platforms. Various web series and movies are being brought to the OTT platforms. This has also led to reduction in the revenues of the cinemas, and given the pandemic, people are opting for the OTTs. However, as we've seen that the government is also trying to regulate the OTTs, because we have content which is violent in nature, something that could escalate.
No, my question is about the theater system would be preferred in future, or OTT would be preferred by the people.
So we are moving more towards OTT. I feel the era of theaters, in my opinion, has passed away, and people would opt more for OTT services.
So future of movies is dependent on OTT, not in theaters.
Sir, the movies will be released in theaters. However, they won't be celebrated in such a fashion like the years in all these years we have seen, because people used to rely on cinemas a lot. But now health has taken the priority and protection given the pandemic. So I feel the OTTs also provide that personalized space. People can watch whatever movies they want to at whatsoever time they want to. And hence, that would be a greater preference.
You see, some of the people criticize movies that because of movies, the violence against women in the society has been increasing because of the content in the movies. Do you agree with that?
So I agree with that. I feel that cinema reflects the society, and the society reflects the cinema. So there is a lot which individuals extract from movies. There is the good as well as the bad. And sometimes people who are not mature or not in their adolescent years, I mean, they are still small in age, they might grasp something which is not appropriate, and they would want to practice such things without realizing the ramifications. Hence, violence is something that has also been seen as a manifestation of the same.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so, Mr. Sohan, interview is over. And now,
sir, one last question. Sorry, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Chauhan, when Tirupati Rao sir was asking, you told that at times there won't be empathy and. Audible? Sir.
Till now you're not audible. Now you're audible.
Yeah. So you said that there won't be any conflict between empathy and constitutional values or law. So I will give you a scenario where, let us assume, I being an IRS officer, I am giving a scenario. Let us assume you had gone for an income tax raid, and you got hold of evidence that the other person had evaded more than 10 crores of tax. But at the present scenario, because of COVID or whatever,
his business was in doldrums, and he, the moment if you live with the 10 crores tax, definitely he has to commit suicide. Don't you think that in such scenarios, your so-called empathy and your rule of law go in crossroads, and there is a complete conflict between empathy as well as rule of law? The moment you levy tax, he will die, or he has to commit suicide because of the manner in which business is underperforming. If you leave the thing, he will just try to continue the same kind of scenario, and taking a cue from him, even others will also start evading taxes. What would you do in such scenarios? Won't there be a conflict between empathy and rule of
law? So in that scenario, what we can do is we can take them to rehabilitative spaces and see to it that they do not commit such actions. However, sir, if they have created such a fraud and they haven't paid their taxes, then that is a crime according to our constitution. So upholding the law in that aspect becomes important. However, we should not leave them on their own, that you can do whatever you want to. If you want to commit suicide, you can commit suicide, but you'll have to pay the tax. What we can do from our side is see to it that several measures are taken where they do not fall into the trap of committing suicide.
So you say that still there is no conflict between rule of law and empathy?
Because, sir, we are practicing empathy right now by taking preventive measures and seeing to it that the individual does not commit suicide.
So you can't follow him all the day, no? See, you have your job to be performed. Would you keep him in your office for the entire day for the coming 1 month or 1 year?
So we would see to it that he is under some kind of psychological consultations and some rehabilitation center where we can take him so he or she does not commit such an action.
You are a civil servant, Chauhan. You are not a doctor in the first place. So think about it, okay? Sir, with this, I shall conclude. Sorry to interrupt.
Okay. So, sir, now let us give feedback to Mr. Chauhan. So, will you start first, Radu, sir?
Okay, sir, I shall start first. Chauhan, one thing what I have observed in you, you have very good confidence, which I like. Matlab, even for any question, you are ready to answer. And you have clarity to the extent what you have prepared. But yes, whenever any kind of tricky question is coming, or and one more thing what I have observed, because you are trying to answer, no? Try to stick to whatever the question has been answered. You are crossing the contours. Let us assume when someone is asking pertaining to one thing, beyond that you are giving so many different loose ends, which people can take it in such a manner that it is very easy beyond a point to really put you to a corner. That kind of information, you see, maybe you have prepared so much on your DAF or other aspects, you are trying to give so much of information. You give an answer which is good, but beyond a point also think what could be asked out of the answer which you are uttering in the first place.
Yes, sir.
The moment you try to tell so much, no? For example, in the last question, why should you tell about rehabilitation and all those things? If you being a civil servant, you are there to just implement the rule of law. And you also gave a passing statement that empathy and rule of law are constitutional values. They don't actually contravene, or there won't be any kind of contradiction. Ethical dilemmas are going to happen, or ethical dilemmas exist till this world and humanity ends. So you can't give a passing statement in the first place. Please understand this. And second thing, one good thing what I have observed when I had asked you about these things, hockey or sports, you gave good answers. See, when I was asking you about Himachal Pradesh and whatever the disaster is happening there, You told that this environmental impact assessment or whatever that is happening, that should be implemented or whatever you said. See, here you, whenever if really there is some mistake happening from the side of government, try to accept the reality. So don't try to completely say, see, you said in such a manner that you would try to get all these things implemented. You never said whether the particular thing was implemented or not. See, for example, what is happening in Himachal Pradesh or Uttarakhand, it is visible that it is man-made disaster beyond a point. The reason is very clear. We are exploiting the nature in such a manner just for harnessing power or whatever, regulation of water.
Yes.
So we are really exploiting the nature leading to these kind of catastrophes. You could tell it directly.
Yes, sir.
That's one thing I observed. Otherwise, confidence-wise, it is good. Don't give general answers beyond a point. That will lead you to some kind of trouble. That's what I felt. Otherwise, composure-wise, it is good and your personality is nice. It is a pleasant personality. But beyond a point, don't give so much of loose ends. That's where I am a little bit worried.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if you understand. Please, one more thing, last thing. You have prepared your answers, irrespective of the question. You are giving that answer and you are not sticking to your question. Whether when Tirupati Rao sir was asking something, beyond a point, you are deviating and you are giving so many loose ends. So sir, please restrict yourself. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So what happens in such an instance is that either I have forgotten the question where I fear the panel member, whether sir, can you please repeat the question, and then I keep continuing, which is something I need to work upon.
Two things, Chauhan. First, take 2 seconds before answering. There is nothing wrong in that, or 1 second, so that you can rephrase your thought process to an extent. If you are not able to understand the question, ask them to repeat, and they are there to repeat the question. So these 2 things, you please work upon that. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Give your feedback.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. So Tripura, sir, you want to give your feedback?
Yeah. Just what Naidu sir said. I just wanted to again reiterate that you take a pause and listen to the question properly and give specific answer.
Yes.
And some questions you are giving generalized answers. Be specific. Like Naidu sir said, take a pause and think for some time.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so shall I give you feedback now?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So, Chauhan, my feedback is that, the positive qualities in you, please continue those positive qualities. One is you are calm, composed.
Yes, sir.
And present. You are always present. And you are very clear in what you are answering. You are very clear. Please maintain that, because it is going to give you very good marks in this year UPSC personal test. Okay? And and then your language is also very good. Your language is very good. You maintain that language. Now, also the first case study, which is asked to you, the first case study situation of what happened to you in your 10th class, 10th grade, you said you very well said that you learned from it and now you're going to give more importance to professional life. Good.
Yes.
However, also the terms, one more thing I should tell you, the terms you are using are also very good. I think you are very, very well prepared. For example, hazard mapping, EIA, consensus based, means you are using the right terms. For example, some questions like when Tripura sir asked me about movies, you said society reflects the movies and movies reflect society. This kind of terminology are generally, they impress the panel members generally. Okay. Now coming to the improvements that you have to make, see, when you're asked to tell the measures, what are the measures you want to take? Tell specifically the measures you want to take. I mean, you no need to tell, sir, government has already taken the measures. For example, when Naidu sir asked you what measures you will take, you just tell me what you will take. You don't tell, sir, government has already taken these steps, government has done this. That is not asked. So here, what has the government done? The question is different. What you will do is different. But if you want to tell what government has done, then you should tell like this. Sir, already government has taken a lot of steps. However, if I am asked to take the steps, cloudburst, yes. When cloudburst happens, drainage is very important, sir. Because a lot of water, yes. because of copious rainfall, a lot of water comes in a short span of time. So providing a good yes. drainage system, we can let the water go instead of flooding. There are specific yes. answers. For example, sir,
yes, sir,
because of landslide, the boulders are coming. To stop the boulders, we may have to build, you know, a wall made with the rocks along the mountain where landslide is possible. Like that, these kind of answers you will get only in two ways. Number one, listen to the question carefully. Number two, what is the last part of the question? Actually, the interview members there are very old members. If you observe their questions,
yes,
they'll be speaking for 2 minutes, 3 minutes, they'll speak, and then finally they'll ask a small question. So you'll yes, keep sir. On listening to the entire thing. Finally, that last two, if you do not listen, then you cannot ask the question. Okay. So
yes,
you can in fact even say, sir, can you repeat the last few words? Sir, you can say that. Can you please repeat the last few words and then get them repeated and then answer to that question. Okay. That is something
yes,
you should do.
Yes, sir. And thank you, sir.
Yeah. And then one more thing. See, always as a civil sir, as you have to be an IAS officer right now. See, you should walk yes. in. You should walk in as an IAS officer to walk out as one. Okay. So,
yes,
as an IAS officer, initially you work at the ground level. So, any questions asked in the DA form also, I know that you prepared very well. You please make some statements at the ground level. For example,
yes, sir.
How Naidu sir asked you, how would you improve volleyball in India? Your answer is expose them to Brazil, Poland, Argentina, international exposure. That is done for the top players generally, which is good. Same with chess also. When you asked about how do you improve chess, you said the top 50 grandmasters of the world, you know, the top players of the interest chess players have to be brought to India. They are the top level yes, answers. They are the top level things you can do. But come to the ground level. Tell it at the ground level.
Yes,
sir, at the school yes, level, curriculum level, you yes, identify the kind of students who actually have the skills of volleyball. You provide them district level championships, district level incentives, yes, prizes, awards, jobs for the people who play nationals. And then you come to the next level, the last level of inter exposure.
Yes,
also, chess
yes,
also. Chess also, sir. Chess players require a lot of time. And mostly from the time they come to 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade, in India, education system is so pressurizing that right from the 8th, yes, 9th, 10th grade, you have to spend so much time on education that the time you require for the chess will automatically fall down. So that should not happen.
Yes.
So you have to ensure
yes,
that the mindset of the family changes. So you have to counsel the parents of those good chess players at the school level so that those parents yes, and teachers do not... At that level should speak. Your answer should be from the ground level. Ground
yes,
level
sir,
answers
yes,
are more given more importance and lower awarded better marks. Okay?
Yes, sir.
That's another
yes,
broad thing that you should observe. Then...
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. And then, yeah. One more thing. See... You are afraid to tell your opinions. In some cases, you are trying to be diplomatic. Of course, it is good that you are diplomatic so that you neither take any extreme stand, be diplomatic. But in some cases, they expect you to come out with your opinion. General UPSC, in the overall interview, somewhere one or two points, they will see whether this candidate is an independent guy. Can he think independently? Can he come out with his opinion bravely? Even if he feels that this opinion may not be accepted by the panel members, this opinion may not be really accepted, even then you come out with the opinion. But again, such opinions is not that, sir, women are a lower gender, sir. I feel women is lower gender. Not such kind of opinions. For example, opinions like, sir, the government as of now, I think, is taking steps, but still at the district level, we have failed. We should do a lot in this case. For example, say, the Gujarat socially backward. See, I know that you are slightly afraid to say that, but yes, it is good that you defend your state. You say that, sir, I think socially Gujarat is not really backward, sir. Maybe in some sectors backward. Maybe the reason is the government is mostly focusing on investment infrastructure rather than spending much on the welfare, sir. That thing I think should be improved. Means you tell that. You can tell that. You don't need to be afraid to say that, no, sir, it is. No one will be afraid to tell that Gujarat is socially backward. Don't be afraid, okay?
Yes, sir.
That's one thing. Then.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Yes, and then, Mr. Chauhan, generally, as I tell to most of the people in the interview, that communication includes two things, good speaking skills and good listening skills. So,
yes, sir.
The panel members there are very old, very experienced members. They know that an IAS officer, IRS, IPS, any officer requires good listening skills. In fact, if you're IRS officer, IAAS, whatever, you have to listen to the people, listen to the customers, clients, listen to the ministers, listen to politicians. Listen. You should be a very good listener. So what most of the candidates think is that I'm a very good speaker. I'm able to communicate my thoughts very effectively. So I'll get very good marks. No, you'll not get very good marks because the marks depend not only on communicating, I mean expressing, but also on listening. Yes, so you should somehow prove that you are a good listener. One technique of proving is that, sir, can you please repeat the last few words? I could not listen to it. Means you're telling them, sir, I am giving importance to what you're asking. I want to listen it. You understand?
Yes.
So it's nothing wrong in asking somebody to tell again. That actually shows your courage also, your courage. You are courageous.
Yes,
if you are unable to listen something, you will tell confidently, sir, I am unable to listen the last few words. Please repeat. Or, sir, can you please repeat the question? Whatever. Of course, sometimes it may be irritating if you keep on asking it. But at least sometimes you ask, okay? Because they definitely there will be marks to the listening skills. Because they can understand. Yes, they think, okay, this guy, he did not understand the question. But he's telling some answer because he's afraid. Means he's not a kind of person who will listen. Okay? That is the next thing I want to tell you.
Thank you so much, sir.
And then, yes, Mr. Chauhan, I know you're preparing for UPSC examination, so your focus is on national current affairs. But believe me, state current affairs is far more important because state is something very close to you than the nation. It means very close surroundings to you. So what is happening is very close surroundings to you, you should have an eye for detail on such things. For example, I asked about Land Grabbing Prohibition Act. This has caught the national attention. Because it's a very harsh act. Even Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh also have similar acts, but their imprisonment was 1 or 2 years. Here, 10 years imprisonment. Take Maharashtra. Yes. Maharashtra land grabbing is a big problem, but even they don't have such an act. And the reason why I related the slums with the land grabbing act is because if the act is implemented, the first people to be thrown in prisons are the slum dwellers only. So please prepare Gujarat current affairs, at least the major acts. You do one thing, next few days, prepare them very well. Gujarat, okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Gujarat is a very interesting state. So there's a chance of asking more questions than any other state, okay?
Yes, sir.
And then I have much more feedback, but we fixed ourselves only 1 hour of time, which is up right now. So I would connect with you personally sometime because I think I have written down much more feedback. But at this point of time, I personally feel that dumping a lot of feedback at once will make all the feedback go into drain, okay? So I will connect with you once again to give you some more feedback. See you, Chauhan.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.